小朋友，现在是非常时期，别在外面溜达，口罩也别戴，赶快往家走。现在这冠状病毒多严重啊，快跑！别再出来了啊，在家好好待着，为社会做贡献。
Got 13 tips slash observations on living and thriving through a pandemic. It is accumulation of knowledge from the 1918-1919 Spanish flu pandemic, which is the only modern one that is aping what is going on with the NCOV 2019. Okay, it is really the only one that is looking like this. Asian flu in 1968, similar, but I think this one's a little bit more interesting. So what are my 13 tips? Well, because I'm a socialist liberal, I've actually got 14, and I may even throw more in. My 14th tip for you is if you live in Outer Mongolia, do not go outside without a mask on, or those drones will find you. So more of that bizarro dystopian viewpoint later on. I really hope that kid doesn't get run over by a car running home as fast as he can on the deserted streets of Outer Mongolia. Statistics are hard to get from 1918, 1919, but in Canada there's a fair amount of statistics available in the Winnipeg area, and I did review a book on that, and it's worth watching that video. Though it's a bit boring for most people because, you know, pandemics just won't happen in our lifetime, right? Anyway, miscarriages went up by about 4 times the normal rate, and that's something people don't think about. I was in our prenatal unit actually at work, and they were saying, well, if this gets bad, we'll be okay. And I said, well, actually, no, you're going to get a lot more customers, and working conditions are going to be a lot worse. And even if you don't get more customers, we'll move you somewhere else. They weren't thrilled with that knowledge, but it's the truth. So first off, the reason they went up by 4 times is because when people are sick, very sick, and they're carrying a baby or a fetus, whichever you want to call it, miscarriage is much more likely. So even in today's world, people who are pregnant really need to treat themselves as a risk of miscarriage right from the beginning of an epidemic like this. Do all the things you need to do with a threatened miscarriage. Resting a lot more than normal, keeping hydrated, avoiding contact with people who are sick, etc., etc., etc. So that's worth thinking about. Some of people aren't really thinking about the actual side effects of a pandemic, and that's definitely one of them that if you've got a baby on board, you might want to think about. Number two is cerebral anoxia. When the lungs aren't able to exchange oxygen, carbon dioxide very well, in this particular case with flu, viral or bacterial, what happens is there's a lower flow of blood to the brain. The brain is very dependent on oxygen. And a tiny number of people become extremely paranoid and violent, usually prior to cardiac arrest. And what happened in Winnipeg was all the nurses got sick because they did, and a lot of them died, and they actually closed the schools, so they forced school teachers to actually go into community homes. And of course, they were all, school teachers were female, nurses were female. And that didn't last more than a few days. Quite a few of them got severely attacked. You know, you don't know what's going on, you're really, really ill, and bang, there's strangers in your house, and you think you're going to die because you feel like you're about to die, because when you have something like this, and they got attacked. So they actually stopped that quite quickly, and they didn't go in without a male. So that's an interesting one. Are you able to actually tie up and restrain a member of your household? I'm sure you're going, yes, I can. Question for you, can your wife tie you up? They might have to, right? It actually affects, in my clinical experience, none of this stuff is medically researched, it's just stuff I've gathered and accumulated. I am a registered nurse. In my experience, that is usually the older 50 plus males, though females can be quite violent. They usually typically are a smoker, they usually typically have a history of hard drinking. So if that's you, tie yourself up now and stay in a cupboard till this is all over, okay? I actually once had a guy stagger out of his room, lift up an oxygen tank and throw it at us. And the oxygen tank was one of the massive ones. Of course, as soon as he lobbed it, and it went about 8 feet, I kept our staff away from him because I was kind of worried. This is in England, years ago. He immediately collapsed and died. No surprise there. So yeah, think about those sorts of things. Beware of fads. In the Spanish flu epidemic, doctors actually said they felt alcohol would help. At that time, there was prohibition in Canada. I mean, you know, Canada's always ahead of America. And they actually, everything with alcohol in it at the chemist just went. doubled or tripled in price. So this is in a very low economic times. Right now, N95s are a bit of a fad because people don't have them, think they need them, and they probably do, and there's limited supply because most of the manufacturing bases in China are shut down, and there's huge demand for them. So that's an example of a needed product that you should have had in place, and if you don't get some somehow or other, don't be spending a huge amount of money on it though. Don't buy into the hype. But something might come across like colloidal silver. People will claim that that protects them from viral pneumonia. Absolute nonsense. But they will firmly believe that, and they will transmit that by social media. And a fair number of people will believe it, and then the price of colloidal silver will go through the roof. There isn't actually anything that we know of that is actually going to reverse flu that's viral, other than a vaccine. We don't have one. No surprise, expect shutdowns, airport, buses, etc., etc. But bars will be shut, restaurants will be shut, theatres will be shut, movie places will be shut. A lot of the malls actually might close. What won't happen is that you won't see mass starvation. With a 1-2% death rate, government will function, essential supplies will get through. They're going to be different. It's going to be a different 3 months if this epidemic, this pandemic, is actually as bad as I think it might get. It's not going to end society. But for 3 months or so, it's going to be very uncomfortable. You're not going to really get non-local product. You're not really going to get much local product. You're going to get an awful lot of stored basic carbohydrates in the stores. And that's one of the things you might want to think about now. Make a trip out to a huge grocery store at a time of day when there's almost nobody there. And load up on things like tinned pineapple and tinned peaches and tomato sauce and all of that stuff and spices. Load up on things that will last 3 to 6 months or longer that you can use daily if you don't want to go out to the store. Because let's be honest here, we've got a bad habit of some people going out every day or even every 2 or 3 days to the store to buy food. Not a smart idea in a pandemic for two reasons. One, it puts you at higher risk of being infected. Two, there might not be anything there. So partially related to the shutdowns is expect massive layoffs. Massive layoffs. Unfortunately, I cannot look forward to that happy event because I work in healthcare and I'm not going to be allowed to quit. I'm fairly sure they'll put that in place pretty early on if it gets as bad as it might get. One of the things that you might experience is temporary loss of hours and probably loss of employment entirely, especially in anything that's been shut down. So you want to do is store up some cash and make some arrangements to have enough money coming in for the next 2 to 3 months to sustain you minimally, okay? Right? Debt's a bad thing at the best of times. This is possibly going to be one of the worst of times. You really need to be thinking about that right now. You should have been thinking about it 5 years ago, but never too late to save up a little bit of cash to try and help you through a lean period. This is going to be quite lean. So the types of products that are going to be available in the store are going to dramatically change. We don't have much stock of anything. Everything's just in time across the planet now. Tens of thousands of boats and planes a day bringing stuff in for our capitalist and consumering lifestyle. And that's going to temporarily kind of grind to a halt or be severely limited. I can foresee that you won't be getting much stuff at all. Now, a lot of people have got the false idea that they'll be able to get local foods and stuff like that. I don't think there'll be many farmers markets open for a while. I don't think there'll be many people coming down to the cities to sell groceries for a while. Not this week, maybe not next week, but if this progresses to a 1.5% to 0.5% death rate from the flu, I really do think it's going to shut down pretty much everything for a 2 to 8 week period. And I think you need to get that on board right now into your heads. I don't know the governments are, but you can because you're smart. And if it doesn't go that way and it fades away, whatever. You were ready if it didn't. Doesn't look like it's fading away. Sort of related to fads, and I mentioned it, face masks. The bottom line is anything that says surgical mask has had no quality testing whatsoever, and you'll be able to see masks that don't fit. Masks have to fit tightly. I haven't done it yet, but I will at some point. I'll probably be wearing a mask on Sunday, maybe, at work. When you're wearing them properly, you actually see the lines here and here from the straps. It's that tight. It has to be that tight. And even that doesn't 100% protect you. Okay? So rather than waste a lot of money, especially if you don't have them, and spend a ton of money on an inadequate surgical mask, consider using a cloth mask with a second cloth mask on it, or a paper mask with a cloth mask on top of that. The key thing is to have multiple of them, so you can take them off frequently and put them in a sealed bag, put bleach water in there, and Brad from Full Spectrum Survival talks about that in one of his videos, and it's easily available online, the strength of that. It's not the same as drinking water with bleach added, by the way. It's a lot more bleach. And then put it through your washing machine with full power and hot. I don't expect electric power to fail. What could happen with this being the time of year is we could have a snowstorm that knocks down the hydro lines. They will be repaired, but there's going to be a lot less crews. Everything's going to be a lot less fast than what we're used to in today's society, if there's a problem. Almost no one's talking about this, certainly on a government level. Most pandemic flus have more than one wave. They can have up to five, I think six waves. Wave 1, 2, 3 is more common, three waves. There's no correlation that I can see between progression of the waves and increase or decrease of the infectivity. If I'm wrong on that, please let me know and point me to the right direction. But wave 1 can be devastating, and the other two can be the same or slightly worse than each other, but nowhere near as wave 1, or wave 2 could be the bad one, or wave 3. We have no way of knowing. The other problem with this, and I'm fairly certain of this, but again, I'm not a research scientist, is that I do not believe, from what I know, that being infected in wave 1 protects you in wave 2. Certainly people in Winnipeg had the flu in more than one wave, and it was the same infection. Now, they weren't doing DNA testing, right? So they could have had two separate types of flu, but people were pretty used to the symptomology by wave 2 and 3 in Winnipeg. So I tend to think, don't falsely think you're protected because you had a mild dose in wave 1. There will be people out there who are insane who will try and get a dose early on thinking that, well, healthcare's up and I won't die. Death rates are going to be pretty constant no matter how healthcare deals with it. If you get a bad strain of this and you end up on a ventilator early on, you probably won't be on a ventilator later on. And I'll talk about that in a bit. You gotta love Big Pharma and the governments. They're actually pushing the regular flu vaccine as protective for this. In no way at all is this protective for this. The only thing it might do is protect you from a secondary flu that they expected to get, and you don't want two types of flu going on at the same time, so it might be worth considering taking the flu vaccine. I currently am not going to do so, but that's my personal choice. Now, there's a lot of stuff online about immunity boosting. Take this, take that, boost your immunity, protect yourself from flu. Whilst that is true for not getting the flu, you're gonna get it if you're in close proximity to somebody who's highly infectious, no matter what you've done. So there's some validity to maybe taking immunity boosters, but one of the main killers in this type of an epidemic is hyperreactivity from young people to the pathogen, the virus. And that's a false, massive reaction from the immune system. So there's no research for this, obviously. You cannot do controlled studies, and doing any sort of studies at the hype of something like this is impossible. But I'd be very careful, especially if you're younger, taking immunity boosting. If you do get it and you get a bad case of it, that might, I don't know, but in my mind, that would make me think you're at more risk from the hyper response and death. I hate to tell you people this, but in 3 months to 6 months, maximum 9 months from today in January 2020, life will be back to normal. Now, it won't be back to normal if it mutates and kills 99.9% of the population, but you know what? There's very little prepping to be done for that type of scenario, and let's face it, the faster that happens, the survivors will have way tons of resources to go about their daily lives.
I know there have been some deaths. I heard it on the radio, but not enough to cause a panic.
It's been played out. I mean, we've had 70 deaths.
70?
It could be double or treble that number by the morning. We took in our first cases about 6 days ago. Now, that seems to be the time it takes for infection.
No, it's much more likely to kill 0.5 to 1% of the population. The odds are good for you, and especially living in the first world, which is a horrific term, in the richer, more exploitive, resource-rich world, we're actually more likely not to suffer the death rates that will occur in places like India and the poorer parts of China. So that's worth thinking about. The actual risk of death here, to you personally, is reasonably low. Now, obviously, if you're a paramedic, you're in trouble once the protective gear that you're using, the single use, runs out, if it's a major pandemic, because it will run out, right? And that's one of the things you might want to be thinking about now if you're a paramedic or a nurse or a doctor or a dentist, because remember, a dentist died in SARS in 2003 in Toronto. You might want to actually provide yourself with additional protective equipment right now for use for you in your home or at work if the supply chains become inadequate. This is anywhere near like Spanish flu, the stock markets around the world will collapse. And about a week or two after they've collapsed, once you realize and assess the fact that we're not losing 99.9% of the population, buy cheap, right? There's going to be a huge buying opportunity for you if you're smart on this. The only problem with this course is if it's 99.9% death rate, you might as well buy the stocks anyway, because money's going to be utterly pointless and valueless after that. Money's going to be fairly valuable in this economy. Relying on credit and electronic means of exchange is not a good idea. That's another reason I would tell you to have a stock of cash and low bills on hand. People may not want to use ATMs for obvious reasons, and cash is always going to be king. Now, be careful of getting infected from handling coins and cash, right? But you might want to have low notes so you don't actually have to take the coins. You can say, no, give them to charity. So there's ways and means around this. And the sooner you get the stock of cash, the less likely the cash is to have viruses on it. One of the things you might want to do if you live in a sunny part of the world is actually put the banknotes out securely and away from sight in the sun for a day or two before you use them. That should reasonably reduce the viral load. Maybe. I don't know. None of this stuff has actually been researched, right? People will tell you stuff with certainty online. Mostly they're talking about opinion and based upon logic. Opinion and logic is not always true. The only way to stop the spread of an infection is complete isolation. Either isolate the people who probably have it, or isolate yourself. In this case, self-quarantining this week and next week is an absolute must. Whatever it takes, however you can do it, without causing yourself to go to prison or lose your children, do it. Be logical. You don't need to have your bangs cut this week. Kitty's mad at me because I won't let her go and have her bangs trimmed. She can wait a couple of weeks. And if it's as bad as it might get, I'll be cutting them for her. And if it gets better, she can go then. Put up with stuff. Don't get normalcy bias going here. Don't go to the gun range with your mates to talk about the pandemic because, you know, you're all hyped up from watching a whole bunch of daft live streams. Think about this. Every person that you meet might be a carrier of this infection. I'll get into that with government stupidity later on. Healthcare is going to be totally overwhelmed. Utterly overwhelmed. We can't cope with this. Army barracks will be converted. Sports stadiums will be converted. They'll find cots. We have lots of cots actually stored up for major accidents and major issues in the province. The big problem is going to be staff. There's going to be very few trained staff floating around. They'll either be sick or they won't be coming to work. So what happened in Spanish flu was that they asked for volunteers initially, and then they asked for retired nurses, and then they just drafted school teachers. And that's one of the issues that we could face in a large-scale, high-volume pandemic. I know the breathless excitement. There's over 12,000 cases and nearly 300 are dead. Puh, that's nothing. It's nothing at all. If we're losing 1 million to 2 million people across the planet, if America has 150 million people sick and 1 million die, healthcare will not stand. It will collapse. So take that on board. Make sure you have your medication stored up. Make sure you're aware that you can deal with this, okay? You might be on your own for a bit. It's always true, any given scenario, but this one particularly is global. It is not located in China. It is global. Last but not least is government stupidity. I keep hearing government sources saying the same message over and over. They weren't infected and in contact with anybody. If this is airborne, and it looks like it is, if this is even mildly infectious, and it looks like it is more than mildly infectious, airborne, while people are asymptomatic, that's garbage. The British particularly are really stupid. Honest to goodness, when the Department of Health England is telling the bus driver on the bus with people evacuated out of Wuhan, that they don't need to wear personal protective equipment because they're not in close contact with the people on that bus. You have to wonder about the intelligence level, okay? You have to wonder what's going on. This is infectious, this is airborne. We don't know how infectious while it's airborne, and we don't know how infectious while it's asymptomatic. China's telling us quite clearly it is, and our governments aren't doing anything. There's a case now in York University in England, and not Toronto, and they're not quarantining the university. Even worse, the university is completely open. The close contacts of that person, they say there were none while she was ill. Because as soon as she got ill, she called for help. Yeah, okay, that's good. That's a good thing to do. But they're assuming that everybody she was in contact with before she got sick is at zero risk. Zero risk. And that if they have it, they won't. Because if they do, they're walking around, going to class, going to parties, etc., etc., infecting other people. This is what seems to have happened in China. They did incredibly strong quarantining of the areas. Didn't work. I don't know why our governments think China's a special case and it'll work here just fine because we have a good public health system. That remains to be seen. The only thing that's going to work here is if it weakens or if we go through it. Well, as ever, there's a lot of information in that one. I hope you enjoyed it. Take care out there. Don't get too crazy about this, but take it seriously. Take it as seriously as Donald Trump's taking it. Can't stand the guy, but he's right to shut down the airlines, and he's probably done it against the advice of the health department, I would assume. Absolutely the right thing to do. Last week they should have cancelled all non-essential air travel. Cancelled it across the planet. Put us into a great sliding stop. Wait and see what happens. You don't wait for the infection to be an airborne pandemic and then go, oh, now we'll stop everything. If you think it's going to happen, and these are very rare events where you have a definitively unknown virus or bacteria that is actually causing human-to-human transfer, when you get that, the World Health Organization should stop all air travel worldwide for non-essential for a period of time. There's no reason why you need to go on holiday. Most air travel is utterly non-essential, okay? Anyway, with that in mind, take it easy, be good. I go back to work tomorrow night dealing with this, and so will Kitty. And we'll keep you posted about what we know when we can, because obviously I'm limited to what I can tell you. But what I will tell you is NCOV 2019 and my hospital isn't over yet. And I don't expect it's going to be over for months. It's going to be a horrible time. But you know what? Keep cheerful. Hug and kiss the people who are close to you, as long as they're not affected. Toodles.
哎呀，这是非常时期，你不戴口罩又往外跑，对吧？那雪过几个月也能化了，对不对？再家里边待着不舒服嘛，对吧？又有吃的，又有喝的，刚过了个年，你干嘛老往外跑，对吧？过几年也能收拾，别笑了，赶紧骑你的三轮车回家，对吧？没事别往出跑，看口罩也不戴，你还看啥？赶紧走，对吧？回家好好待着去。
非常时期啊，赶紧回去。对面那个电动车上装着粉色挡风被的大哥，请你戴上口罩啊，戴上口罩。打电话的帅哥，这口罩呢？赶紧给戴上。迎面走过来的美女，边上的那位帅哥，看到你戴着口罩了啊，把口罩戴戴好，戴戴好。边走边吃了几位美女。 抓紧的把口罩戴上，东西可以回家吃。
It's a Bad Terrier 2020 production.